business first, right?
Yeah. Oh, it is.
Whenever you're ready.
Broken, it'll be all right, but right now,
God Almighty reigns. Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty
Well, it's Thanksgiving week. Is the mic on? Is it? Okay. I can't tell. Are you excited about Thanksgiving?
Yes.
Yes.
It is a wonderful holiday. It's a time for us to get together with family and friends. You have a break from school this week. That's exciting. And there's something that many of us do and focus around on Thanksgiving. And what is that? Eating. Yes. The holiday certainly centers itself around eating. And there is a star of the meal. There's lots of dishes, usually more than normal. In my experience, I used to go to my grandmother's house for Thanksgiving when I was a kid, and it was so much food. They were farmers. They knew how to cook, and they had it all. But there is something that's the star. What's the star of the meal for Thanksgiving? Turkey.
I brought one with me today.
I just got it from the store. Here it is. Oh, think it's going to be big enough? You want a bite?
No.
You want to have some?
Yeah.
You are a brave boy. This turkey could be for Thanksgiving. It has potential, doesn't it? But right now, I see some obstacles to eating this turkey. It's wrapped in netting and plastic. That would be hard to chew through. And it's cold. My hands are cold. It's frozen solid. And it's raw. No one should eat raw turkey, ever. So, obstacles, actually I looked obstacles up in the dictionary, one of my favorite things to do. It says a thing that blocks one's way or prevents or hinders progress. There's no progress here in eating this turkey. It is not ready, but it has potential, right? We can overcome these obstacles. We can thaw it. We can unwrap it, season it a little bit, put it in the oven, or some people put it in a grill or a roaster or a smoker or a deep fat. I don't know. Everybody has a choice of how they cook their turkeys. But you can cook it, and then it will be delicious. It isn't always that easy to overcome obstacles in our life. That's pretty easy. It's doable. But we see things in our life, and we think, oh, I don't know how to get over this. And some of the obstacles are just plain fear in our life of doing something that we don't want to do, that we should. Sometimes it's time, money. Sometimes we just don't know what to say or do. But those are obstacles that are a little harder. But God tells us that those obstacles can be overcome. And there's an opportunity for something good to come out of some issue that you might have. We need to keep a thankful heart instead of grumbling. And we need to keep our focus on God instead of our problems, because he's there to help us. I have a couple verses I want to read to help bring that truth to light from God's word. And one of them is in Philippians. Chapter 4, verse 6, and it says, do not be anxious or afraid or any of those feelings about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, that means asking for, and with thanksgiving, present your request to God. So it's saying pray about what your problem is. God is there for you. And this verse really brings it home. It says in Isaiah 41, chapter 41, verse 13, For I am the Lord your God. He's talking to you, who takes hold of your right hand. Can you imagine God holding your hand? And says to you, do not fear. I will help you. That's pretty awesome. God loves you. He wants to be with you. And he wants to see you through every obstacle that you have. So as you go to Children's Church today, I want you to remember that every obstacle is an opportunity for God to do some amazing things in your life. And that, boys and girls, is something to be thankful for. Amen. It's time to go to Children's Church. Thanks very much for being here. I'm going to go put this back in the freezer.
Thank you, Sister Margo.
Not ready to thaw yet.
Our opening song this morning will be This Is Amazing Grace, and in the song it talks about just how amazing his grace and the power of that grace. So if you're able, please stand and we'll join in song.
Sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole world with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless and all in wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Who brings
our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set done for me.
Man, you may be seated. I love starting off with the energetic songs and just how excited it is that the grace that he has for us. And what's even more exciting is tonight, here in this building, we're going to be meeting with other families and our brothers and sisters in Christ here in the Valley. Brownsville Church of the Brethren's coming. Fellowship Baptist, Community Baptist, Fellowship Community, I'm going to get it right. Fellowship Community Baptist Church is coming up. And then Mount Moriah. Whew. Really nailing this announcement. But that's at 6 o'clock here tonight at this church, and we're going to gather together as one family under in his name. Afterwards, there could be some refreshments and things downstairs, so we welcome you to that as well, and get to know your brothers and sisters in Christ from the Valley. And then lastly, the Women's Black Friday Dinner is going to be in Frederick at 5 p.m., so there's still time to sign up to attend. If you would like to, please see Cindy for details.
The reading this morning is from the book of Psalms, 34, verses 8 through 22. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Sorry, please rise. It's my first time here. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. O fear the Lord, you his saints. For those who fear him have no lack. The young lions suffer and want and hunger. But those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is there who desires life and loves many days, that he may see good? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Turn away from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are towards the righteous and his ears towards their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, and cut off the memory of them from the earth. When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of all of them, out of them all. He keeps all his bones, not one of them is broken. Affliction will slay the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be condemned. The Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned.
We're going to continue standing as we go into our next song, Hosanna, which Hosanna is a form of praise. It's a form of reaching out to God and just recognizing who he is and what he's done. It's lifting our voices to him. So let's do that right now.
Washed away, Hosanna. the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. Welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
Our voices, our prayers. Let's say,
Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Jesus, we truly know that in our souls it is well. It is beyond anything that we do. It is otherworldly. It's heavenly because He is perfect.
When peace like a river attends sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, Thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. It is well. But the whole so it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul.
Amen. You may be seated.
I really do want to encourage you, since this is a season of Thanksgiving and we are getting ready to go into Christmas, to try to attend their community Thanksgiving service to show support for not only the cooperating churches, but also to help us express our thanksgiving to God. And if you have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Peter. We will be in 1 Peter, and the only other place I'll allude to this morning will actually be in 2 Peter, so if you want to turn there when I get there, at least you're only one book away. How many of y'all know a U.S. Marine? Not very many people. How many are U.S. Marine? I have one little baby back here, raise her hand. But anyhow, even though they act like that sometimes, that's not true. The U.S. Marines, if you ever wondered about them, they are probably one of the most fierce fighting forces that the U.S. or the world has ever seen. And you know what? Are they arrogant? Absolutely. But do they deserve that arrogance, or do they earn that arrogance? I'd say probably so. The U.S. Marines can look over their shoulders back at history against insurmountable odds and show how they have conquered and persevered in the midst of adversity. Even Hollywood seems to capture the characteristics or the characters of the U.S. Marine Corps. When you see movies like John Wayne in the Sands of Iwo Jima talking to the recruits as he is sitting there pushing them forward just on the heels of World War II, you can understand that. And as the Marine recruits go through what's called the crucible, and they come out of the other side and they graduate to actually become a U.S. Marine. Do you know that there's no such thing as a former Marine? And they will point that out readily. There is no such thing as a former Marine, because once a Marine, always a Marine. And they allow you to know that. And the reason that I bring that up is because they have been transformed through a crucible through which they've gone through in order to be something that they didn't used to formerly be. And Peter, through this particular book, is talking about how we have undergone and gone through something, and we've come out the other side, and we are totally transformed and totally changed, except we come out on the other side of it not being arrogant, but being humble to be a different people for God's calling. And so I wanted to bring this up because I really believe that I've done a dismal job on showing how Peter is talking about suffering and how suffering has formed who we are and how Jesus Christ is our example in the midst of suffering. And by the way, if you're a guest here this morning, we're going through 1 Peter, and we happen to be in chapter 3 starting in verse 8 this morning, which I'll be there in a moment. So let me give you just a little bit of the context. When chapter 2, we read as a whole, it captures what Peter's trying to convey to us about Jesus' suffering and their respective suffering. Now look with me, starting in chapter 2, verse 1. Now chapter 2, verse 1 leans back on the end of chapter 1, and it tells us that we are new creatures because of the gospel, because we have responded to the saving grace of God's message, and we've been saved by Jesus. And because of that new reality, Peter identifies us as citizens of a new kingdom, if you keep your eyes there in chapter 2. And in verse 4, he calls us a chosen, special being built up into the spiritual house of God's dwelling. And as his house, we are to offer spiritual sacrifices through what we do. All of this in the midst of suffering. And then in 2:6, Jesus is our foundational cornerstone from which we build our entire life off of. And then in drop down to 9, we have been redesigned. We have purpose. He says, you are a chosen race. You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation. You are a people for his own possession. And that is purpose. God has given us purpose from the effect of the gospel that has transformed us. And look at what it says, that you might proclaim, or you may proclaim, the excellency of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. And then verse 12. So to act, we are to act so differently that the perishing would take notice. We are on part three of this series, the suffering and the suffering of Christ. And we looked at how the suffering separates us from the world. This isn't our home. We are merely passing through. Suffering produces Christian conduct in chapter 3, verses 1 through 22. We live in a broken world. And these people lived in a broken world. And there's things that are topsy-turvy according to God's original design. And in that design, God had a plan for how we're to relate to one another as a husband and wife. And we need that reminder because we live in a broken world. Last week, we looked at the conduct in the home between husband and wife. And today, we're going to look at how our suffering and the suffering of Christ should form and determine and develop Christian conduct in the church as we are seen in the middle of the world. In chapter 2, verse 21 is the linchpin that comes, that connects all these ideas, how Christ's suffering and our sufferings form these things within them. Read with me in chapter 2, verse 21. This is the linchpin of the entire book of 1 Peter. He says, "For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth." Do you see that? Jesus lived in a sinful, fallen world. Jesus did not retaliate. Jesus stayed steadfast. Jesus was our example. So Jesus, in the midst of his suffering, was an example to us as we go through a world that is topsy-turvy, that is antagonistic towards God, antagonistic towards Christ, that we're not supposed to retaliate. And he says, going on, when he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to the one who judges rightly. Verse 24, he himself bore our sins on his body on a tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness, which is what Jesus did for us, because we were part of that hostile world at one time. Jesus took that from us until he died and placed his righteousness on us. By his wounds you have been healed. For you were straying like sheep. We were in that antagonistic world. But now we have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. Jesus lived in a broken world. And we were part of that broken world. And we lived on the other side of the tracks. And Jesus came to this world in order to live a perfect life and die for sinful people, so that he could bring us across the tracks to live in the kingdom that he lives in. This is how Jesus' suffering was an example to us that these are the type of people we are supposed to be, because we have been formed and transformed by the gospel message. And today we're going to look at how Jesus set the example by operating in a broken world with redeeming quality. That's what Jesus did. That's why Jesus did what he did. That's why Jesus suffered what he suffered, so that he lived a redeeming quality about his life. And we're supposed to do that and have a redeeming quality towards one another. Now let's read our text. Start. I was looking for my glasses. I got them on my face. Now you know that I'm getting old. You see, I've had AARP. I've had AA. And I've gotten the shingle shot. And looking towards... I'm getting there, guys. I'm getting there. So let's read our text starting in verse 8 of chapter 3. Finally, I want you to look at the second word. The second word encompasses how many people in here? All, right? Before he's talking about husbands and wives, before he's talking about how we relate to our overseers, now Jesus is not just saying about husbands and wives. He's not talking about overseers. This is one of the passages where you don't need to have a PhD or an MDiv or even a bachelor's in theology. All means all, and all, that's all that all means. So it's pertaining to us. It's a very relevant passage. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, and tender heart, and a humble mind. Now, he's not talking about those within the church to the church, because that would be taking it out of its context. He's talking about those in the church for the purpose of those outside the world. Do not repay evil for evil or reveling for reveling, but on the contrary, bless, for to this you are called, that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love and see a good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. That sounds familiar, doesn't it, Jerry? Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled, but in your hearts regard Christ as Lord, as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asked you for the reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good than it should be, for it should be God's will, than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sin, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison, because they formerly did not obey, when God's patience waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were brought safely through waters. Baptisms, which correspond to this, now saves you, not as to remove the dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers having been subjected to him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, this is a large passage, and it is written to all of us, and I pray that you would use this as you see fit for each and every one of us here this morning. You tell us that we are to have unity of mind, and if we gather nothing out of it, that we are to be a light in a dark world, that we are to have such an example among the lost in a broken world that they wonder at us. They might even ask us about it. And Father, it's been a long time since somebody's asked me, why do I handle things the way that I handle them? And I think, Lord, it could possibly be because this passage is not resonated home. Lord, I pray that you drive this passage home with me first and everybody else that's here today. And I pray this in your son's name. Amen. I hate looking at the clock, and I have some people that tell me that, you know, don't look at the clock, don't worry about that. But if you didn't have that clock up there, I'm afraid I don't know how many days we'll be here. I want to just reinforce that Peter is taking the text from how we respond as citizens of our national government and how husbands and wives interact with one another to how Christians should act all the time, everywhere, in a broken down world. And I know this to be the case because, one, it's only temporal for the believer. We're just merely traveling through. And secondly, I know this because the text makes it clear in 2:21 that Jesus did this as an example for us. And I want to address the latter part of our text that we're actually dealing with this morning before we get to the main point of our text. And as Peter has pointed out over and over how Jesus has been our example. And in verses 18 to 22, which is a difficult text that has somewhat different interpretation, I do believe 18 through 22 is an illustration of how Jesus was our example and how Jesus preached through Noah during a difficult time in the Old Testament. He preached to the Old Testament people who were abstinent to him. And so I want to go ahead and break down this passage just a little bit. And so if you would get back with me and look at verse 18, we're going to deal with that. I usually try to skirt through some more difficult things, but I'm going to spend just a little bit of time in here, and then I'm going to go to our main point. And he says, "For Christ also suffered once for sins." This is pointing out the hostility of the world that he lived in, pointing out the hostility of the world that we lived in, that we live in, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. This is why we're supposed to proclaim the gospel to other people. This is what we're supposed to do. Being put to death in the flesh, made alive in the spirit. Elsewhere, Scripture tells us that we are to die to the flesh and to live according to the spirit. Verse 19, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah. Now, that's the key part to understanding this particular passage, is that he's talking about Noah being a herald or a preacher of righteousness, preaching to wayward or lost people. We'll see that in 2 Peter. I'll point to that in 2 Peter in a moment. He said, because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is eight persons, who were brought safely through the water. And if you've attended church for any time, or if you've been in part of a Sunday school, if you've heard of any type of preaching, you've inevitably heard that this particular passage is alluding to Jesus actually descending into hell and preaching to those who are lost in order to give them a second chance at salvation because they've never heard the gospel message in their entire life. And I'm going to tell you from a theological perspective, that is hogwash. I'm just going to flat out tell you that. I've heard preachers preach that, but that's not what's going on in this particular passage. People do not go to sin, do not die and go to hell because they have rejected Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. That's news for some people. Because you don't. You do not go to hell for rejecting Jesus Christ and Lord as Lord and Savior. You go to hell because you have sin. Jesus removes that sin. By accepting Jesus as Lord and Savior, that sin is removed and we go to heaven. So we know that Jesus is not going to hell to proclaim the gospel because they've not had an opportunity to hear them, because there's people all over the world that died that never have heard Jesus Christ and they do not get a second chance at heaven. So where does this notion come from? It comes from the Apostles' Creed. The Apostle Creed's claim that Jesus descended during his 3 days in the grave, that he went down there and he preached to those in heaven in order to give them an opportunity to respond to the gospel. That is where it comes from. So what's going on in this passage? This passage speaks to a time where and when Jesus pre-incarnate preached through Noah to a world that was perishing because it was inflamed in sin. Now, if you want to take your Bibles and turn with me to 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5, you'll see that Noah, in that passage, keeping with this particular passage, that Peter calls Noah, or the Bible, or God's Word, call Noah the herald of righteousness. And he was actually proclaiming the need to repentance as he was building the ark. He was preaching a salvation message, and I believe it was Christ Jesus preaching through Noah to those who were disobedient. They are the ones that are referred to as the captive spirits back in 1 Peter. Verse 20 seems to substantiate this. It says because, and I'm back in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 20, because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is eight persons, who were brought safely through the waters. Now the next section in here, starting in verse 21, talking about water and baptism and using the word saved, is a little bit confusing. So I actually want to use the part of the ESV study notes. I want you to know that I'm not plagiarizing, but I've modified it to put it in here what I think best explains it. So what is verse 21 in this whole baptism thing and about being saved? And again, I want to point to the study notes of the ESV to help us. There is a comparison that is being drawn between salvation in the ark and baptism. In both incidences, believers are saved through the waters. Saved, I'm just using that as a relative sense. The mere baptism nor the ark actually saves anybody, for Peter explicitly says not as the removal of dirt from the body. So Peter is reinforcing that baptism or the waters, none of it cleanses us from sin. Baptism, likened to this, baptism represents inward faith as evidenced by one's appeal to God for forgiveness of one's sin. Baptism is the visual representation of the fact that Christians are clothed with Christ. We died in His likeness, and we died in His death, and we are raised to righteousness, and we walk in the newness of His resurrected life, and we share the victory over sin. Here, Noah's family on the ark, they're going through the waters, being saved from the judgment, which represents Christians going through the water of baptism, symbolizing our spiritual identity with Jesus who saved us. In both of those incidences, it has nothing to do with us saving ourselves. It has to do with God being the one who saves individuals. Whether it happens to be Jesus preaching through Noah, the people are saved as they go through the waters because they respond to God's grace. Or whether we respond to God's grace visually by submitting ourselves to baptism as we go through the waters. Now remember, verses 18 to 22 was an illustration. It was an example for us, pointing to how Jesus, through Noah, preached to an exceedingly hostile world, which we are called to do earlier on in chapter 2. And Jesus did it with passion and compassion and dignity and respect. And this is something that He commands all of us to do. It doesn't matter whether you're employed or whether you're retired or whether you're old or whether you're young, whether you're educated or not. Verse 8 instructs us all how we are to act and interact in a hostile foreign world that we now live in. And remember, 2:21, the linchpin, Jesus is our example. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, humble mind. This is for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord. Verse 9, do not repay evil for evil or reveling for reveling, but on the contrary, bless those, for this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. Have you ever noticed and Scripture tells you the same thing over and over again and again in 150 different places? You ever notice that? Do you ever wonder why? Can anybody just speculate as to why it tells us that over and over and over and over again? Not just that. We don't listen. How many times have you had to tell your kids, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that? Over and over and over again. And so God has to tell us over and over and over again. And this is what He's doing and telling us here. That hit a funny bone over there. But that's what it does. Because we need to be reminded of it daily, who we are, that our lives have been bought with a price, that we belong to somebody else. We are to behave differently in a world that so desperately needs to see Jesus Christ, and we are supposed to be that example as Jesus was that example to us. In the flesh, we have short memories. We have short memories of two things. We have short memories that we're just passing through this world. Sunday mornings, we hear it preached, we read it in the Word, we study it on our devotional time. We hear it over and over and over. We're just passing through. And then almost before the lunch hour is over with on Sunday afternoon, we're so immersed in the world we've done forgotten about that we're only temporary citizens and we're just simply passing through. And the second thing is that we have a tendency to forget that we are a Christian and that Jesus actually died for us. Doesn't take long. All you got to do is get on 270 and head down towards 495. And soon as somebody cuts us off. That's another funny bone back. It's not even supposed to be a funny message this morning. The first thing you want to do when you see this maniac speeding by you 100 miles an hour and they swerve in front of you and you know that they didn't look in your mirror, first thing that comes to your mind is, I hope they get a ticket. I call them bear bait. That's what I call them. And secondly, if you're really upset and it happens to be the second or third person, is that you hope that they're in an accident but they're not hurt. Now, don't look at me that way. You all have thought it. I know that you've thought it. Or when somebody throws a huge party and you thought that you were really close to that individual and you find out that the party has already taken place and you weren't even invited. You start questioning your relationship with other people. Or if somebody steals your firewood down there in Weaverton Road. But anyhow, that's only a few of y'all know what's going on with that. Many people, including Christians, they call this karma. They hope that bad things will happen to people who do bad things, but there's no such thing as karma. I talk about that ad nauseum, but that's something for a later time. Peter is telling us that we're supposed to not just punching bags, but Peter's telling us that we're to live so different in the world that the world would actually see something in us that causes them to take notice. Peter, based on how Jesus lived and died, is how we are to interact with a hostile world for which we temporarily live. Verse 9, Peter reminds us that we have been saved and set apart from the world to be a blessing to those around us. And in verse 10 through 12, Peter points back to the Old Testament, back to what Jerry read in Psalms 43, to show us how the lifestyle is meant to be an intrinsic character deeply woven into the fabric of God's people. And then in verses 13 through 17, Peter reminds us that no matter what, no matter who, no matter when, we are to walk through this world and be a blessing to those that are around us. There's two things that I think keep people from coming to church. I think the church doesn't act like the church often enough, and I don't believe that we are serious enough about the gospel to actually share the gospel with those around us. Two things that are woven into this particular book, that we are supposed to be a blessing to those around us, and we are saved and redeemed to proclaim the excellency who has called us out of darkness into His marvelous light. Peter tells us to be a blessing to those who can strike fear in us and can harm us, perhaps even kill us, because he reminds us in Christ that no one can do anything to us other than to send us to heaven, to our heavenly home. I view dying as winning. I really do. I view dying as winning. I don't know if I'm at that spiritual walk. I don't know if I'm at that life stage. I don't look forward to the process because I've not done it, but I am at that stage where I win. I die, I win. I hope that you get there. I really hope that you get there. Because there'll always be something else that you want to do, and it's always attached to the world, and it will always call you to want to be here rather than go there. We're supposed to not only want to go there, we're supposed to claim that, proclaim that to other people in order to bring them along with us. In verse 16, Peter tells us that we need not take revenge or retaliate for those people or on those people, because justice and revenge is God's department. In Psalms 51, when David committed an adulterous affair, it started out with lying and it ended up with murder. He realized that sin was ultimately against God. David hurt a whole lot of people through it. He hurt the commander of his army. He called Uzziah to get killed. He committed an adultery against Bathsheba, and he lied to all those people around him. But David, when David was faced with what he'd done, he realized that God was the ultimate judge and that his sin was against him. And here in verse 16, we are reminded that God establishes the law. He is the jury, he is the judge, and he is the executioner. We have nothing to worry about for those who commit evil against us. Nothing at all. Does that mean that we never seek justice? No. Romans 13 tells us that's the reason that God has established the justice. They are an arm of justice of his in order to execute justice against those who do wrong. And verse 15 is the glue that solidifies all up until this point. Acting like Jesus, suffering for Jesus, suffering from the hands of those who are lost and have no hope. Peter tells us that by doing so, that by chance someone might come to you and just say, why don't you punch that dude in the face? Why don't you call your best friend out for who took credit for your idea? How come you didn't cry out to your boss or your employer when somebody else got a promotion that you thought that you were rightly deserved? Peter's saying that we are to act so differently that people might just come to us and ask us, why are we different than anybody else that they know? And so I want to deal with this last part. Hopefully I'll be fairly quickly. Starting at the end of verse 14, look at what he says. Have no fear nor be troubled. And verse 15 is what I really want to get to, but have no fear, be troubled. We're living in a hostile world, but in your hearts, honor Christ. That's our Savior. He is the one that was sent in order to redeem us. As Lord, that Jesus is our Master. As holy, Jesus is the separate one. That's what we're supposed to be. Now I want you to listen. Do you have this part? Remember, this is for all. Always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asked you for the reason for the hope that is in you, yet do this with gentleness and respect. When someone asked you why you're different or handle things differently, do you point to the cross? Because that's the only reason that we're different than the rest of the world, is because of the effect of the cross. That's what Peter is talking about when he tells us that we are to give a reason for the hope that is in us. How do we know that? Peter tells us, and he uses the word, make a defense. In other translations, says to give an apology for the hope that you have. And the truth is there's no English, or there's no word from one language to another language to 100% capture what is going on in the Greek. And the Greek word is apologia. And apologia means, closest we can get to it in English, is an apology. And it's not saying that we're sorry for what we are or who we are in Christ. An apology, based on the Greek, actually means to give a formal defense, to be able to articulate clearly to other people that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. When it says sanctify Christ in your heart, set him apart in your heart. Always being prepared. Are you prepared as a Christian, because this goes to all, are you prepared to give a response to anybody or everybody who asked you, why do you have this hope that's within you? This is the reason why I started Three Circle Evangelism going on probably about 10 weeks ago now. It's because one of the things that I've learned by going through this is that it's easy up here, but it's difficult right here. And we don't have the words. But the Bible tells us that we're supposed to have the words all the time and be ready to give a defense or give a formal argument. We don't win people by arguments. To give a formal argument on why we have hope. That's what 1 Peter is about. That's what the whole Bible is about. Is for us to be able to be prepared and be ready to give a defense and to proclaim the excellency of Him who called us out of darkness into His marvelous light. And I want to close with this. Can you do that? You know, one of the things about Three Circle Evangelism that I like is that we get to practice with one another. And it's a workshop. And if somebody comes to you and they ask you the simple question, you know, what's going on in your life, or they come to you with a problem, you can say, you know what? I've come to believe a long time ago that God had an original design. He had a design for your marriage. He had a design for your life. He had a design for how your relationships go with other people. He had a design for how you work, how you spend money. He had a design for parenting. And the problem with that design is that all of us have left that design because we figured that we can get there faster. We would be more fulfilled quickly. The Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Leaving God's perfect design means that we have sinned. And when we sin, we land in a state that we know called brokenness. And you know what brokenness feels like, right? Loneliness, despair, confusion, anger, guilt. And everybody tries to mitigate brokenness. We don't want to stay there, so we try to get our way out of it. Some of us resort to throwing ourselves into work. Some of us just try to be better people. Some of us throw ourselves into alcohol. Some of us throw ourselves into hobbies. Some of us throw ourselves into all different kinds of areas of life. And we try to mitigate that brokenness. But the one thing that we realize is that we can never escape it because we always come back to the exact same place. But there's really good news, and it's called the gospel. And the gospel says you do not have to stay in brokenness. Because God has got a plan to pull you out of that. In God's plan, God sent His perfect Son, Jesus Christ, in order to follow that design perfectly. God sent Him to this world in the form of man to follow that design. He placed Him on the cross. Jesus died and He was buried on the third day. And why is that so important? Because Jesus walking on that cross, doing what we were supposed to do, if we repent and believe in that, in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, a miracle takes place. Jesus' perfect work on this world gets counted to us, and our sins go unto Jesus Christ. And after that happened, God gives us the power to be able to pursue and recover back to His original design. Peter is telling us, whatever word you use, that is what we're supposed to tell people. You do not have to stay there. And we can't expect lost, hostile people to act like saved, kind people. It just doesn't work that way. But we have the only message that's going to pull them out of darkness into light. Brother Town, would you play us a song of invitation? Can you talk to somebody about Jesus Christ? Can you offer them hope? It's not going to be easy at times, but it's necessary because Who was all for? All people. Everybody that belongs to Him.
Please stand if you're able.
Holy Spirit, breathe on me. Till my heart is clean, let sunshine fill its inmost part with not a cloud between. Breathe on me, breathe on me. Holy Spirit, breathe on me. Take thou my heart, cleanse every part. Holy Spirit, breathe on me. Holy Spirit, breathe on me. My stubborn will subdue. Teach me in words of living flame what Christ would have me do. Breathe on me, breathe on me. Holy Spirit, breathe on me. Take thou my heart, cleanse every part.
Thank you so much for this day where we have had the time to come together to unite our hearts in praise and thanksgiving. And we thank you, Lord, for the message today. We just pray that as we know that we are changed because of the power of the Holy Spirit within us, that we'd be that light to the world and be able to take that message of Jesus Christ dying for our sins, after walking a perfect life on this earth and raising again from the dead, that all would be able to come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Maybe this week someone will ask us, why are you different? And we'd be able to tell them the truth, the only truth that matters, that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. Be with us as we go our way today. Bring us back together this evening that we'd be able to worship and praise and give thanks to you. This is the time of year where we are thankful for so many things that we have. We just pray that we would just acknowledge that everything we have belongs to you, whether it's our relationships or whether it's the items you've blessed us with, our jobs, whatever. Father, we just pray that we would keep our eyes focused on you and give thanks to you in all that we're about. We ask for these blessings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
And our sending song will be the chorus of Hosanna.
Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us, we welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
Great Thanksgiving and see you tonight.